Welcome to Shades of Brown. This highlights on the many issues affecting Africans and people of African descent. I'm your host, Ramatu Adao Chikliye.
Hello guys, today's a brand new episode of the vlog and I'm wearing green, my least favorite color. And have you guys noticed I love print? I really, really love print. Anyway, today I want to talk about something that happened to me a while back while I was trying to hustle, trying to do, I don't even know what it was about, but it was a point where I was desperate. I was looking for something, I needed something. And as a result, I made some really foolish choices. So I'm titling this one, Desperate Measures. I always use every opportunity to learn from life. Some of the lessons are easy to swallow, but others are just bitter pills, even if you pinch your nose and close your eyes. Take my house issue, for example. Immediately after my service year, I got a nice apartment in an upscale neighborhood. The rent should have been cutthroat, but because one of my pastors was related to the owner, it was very affordable. I was told the owner was out of town and wanted someone to ensure the house wasn't empty. The house was a three-bedroom flat and I was given one room. The owner's nephew was in one room and the other room was leased out from time to time. I was okay with the arrangement. I was hardly home, so I never had any run-ins with my housemates, neighbors, or their family. A week after I moved in, I had this desire to return home early, and when I did, I could not believe the scene that met my eyes. The neighbor's kids were playing football inside the living room. I was livid. The dust they had kicked up and the dirt they brought in turned the room I had swept that morning into a refuse dump. Turns out the neighbors wanted me to settle in before showing me how things were done. From that day, things changed a lot. I will come home to a messed up kitchen with the sink filled with days of unwashed dishes, pots blackened from improperly set stoves, and pieces of food on the floor. Rats had a field day in the kitchen and one had the effrontery to chase me. I mean, the rats looked at me and chased me. The owner's nephew had the kids from the other flat to do his cooking and the dishes, and so he could not be bothered if the dishes were done or not. He didn't go into the kitchen except to fetch water, so he was okay with the smelly, dirty, and nasty excuse of a kitchen. I wasn't, and I raised the issue with him many times until we were at a point where we were barely speaking. I had kids coming into my room and taking stuff when I so much as stepped out to get something. I caught one little girl going through my bag one evening. I stood behind her quietly to give her the benefit of doubt. I was right. She was a little thief. She snuck in after I'd seen a friend off and left the room open. When she turned and saw me, she could have died. I called her much older sister and had her handle the issue, but not before banning her from entering the house, whether I was there or not. All of these weren't as bad as when the next door flat bought a rickety I passed my neighbor generator. He put the generator right at my window with the exhaust facing my room because he didn't want to face the church we shared a fence with. Night after night, I'll be poisoned with carbon monoxide and disgruntled with the irritatingly noisy generator set. It got worse when he came into some money and bought a bigger generator. Since we had problems with electric supply, the generators would be on for almost 24 hours. As a result of the constant drone of the generator, I always woke up with a nasty headache which only dimmed as the day wore on. In fact, the man came to me one day and said, "You did try for this noise, so thank God my room is really far from the generator." If you know me, you probably know the facial expression and the subsequent reaction I gave them. I didn't care that he was a pastor. I desperately needed to leave the house. The sky spirits, in King Julian's voice, were in agreement. The owner of the house died and his wife needed money to bury him. She left Lagos and came to Yola. She didn't expect to find people in her house. Yes, they had tenants in the other houses, but the thought of tenants in her house shocked her. She said her husband would never have given the house to tenants. Turned out the nephew was the one who gave the house out to make some extra money on the side, and he told no one about it. The entire house deal was a shoddy affair, and said nephew had left the country for school, if that is what it really is, or it really was. I was stuck. I had no receipt, no evidence of payment, and quite frankly, no reason to be in that house. After much discussion, the widow agreed to let us stay in the house if we were willing to pay a 50% raise on the house rent that her nephew-in-law had collected. When I told her I could not afford that, she told me to either, you know, pay or pack up and leave, and she gave me 2 weeks in which to do that. I weighed the messy kitchen, the lousy neighbor's kids, horrible power situation, the constant poisoning and noise pollution, and I knew I would not pay 50% extra to continue living like that. Did I forget to mention the rats? I started going up and down and blowing up people's phones for agent contacts. When I say agents, I mean house agents. I was looking at houses for a whole week after the ultimatum. My shoes were suffering. I wasn't eating or sleeping well, and I was dropping weight by the pound. But I wasn't going to give up on my house search. The houses were either too expensive or in a neighborhood that were not friendly. Even though life was bashing me, I knew I had no option but to push on. 2 days to the end of the ultimatum, I headed out with my friend to look at some houses. We got to a neighborhood that was neither upscale nor completely ghetto. They were offering 2 rooms for a little above the price of my house. Yeah, it wasn't great. I had to share the toilet and live with mostly uneducated people, but I needed a house. I was desperate for a house. I paid for the house and finally breathed a sigh of relief. In 2 days, I moved to my house and prepared to get accustomed to my new settings. I should never have breathed that sigh of relief. The house was much, much worse. I had inconsiderate neighbors and I got attacked. My neighbors in the new house were so much worse than the ones I had to deal with at the old house. Everyone had, and I passed my neighbor generator set, and they all came on as soon as it got dark. At least in the old house, I was only suffering with one. But this time around, everyone had it. Talk about the poisoning. I had to continually bless God for not dying. I used to have so much carbon monoxide in my room that my eyes were always red and my chest always hot. I still have that as a side effect from that. And oh God, the noise. Oh God, the noise. If the generator in my old house was noisy, the ones in my new house were a racket from hell. I would lay awake all night listening to the kata 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 drone of generator, and I would curse from here to Africa. Trust me, I stopped cursing in 2014 and picked it up as soon as I had to live in that house and with those people. I also had to deal with absolutely dirty neighbors who would use the very public toilet and not flush or rinse. Okay, I'm gonna relax. If you haven't lived with dirty people, please, please, please don't you ever do that. Ever, don't do it. They're just nasty. Dealing with my neighbors and the attack really messed up my head so much so that I wanted to just pour salt in my neighbor's generator and kill someone. I'm all wicked, but the thoughts came into my head. The moment the rain came, my troubles multiplied. My area flooded every time it rained. The flood water didn't enter the room from the door but seeped from the floor and created large puddles in the room. One night, I was sleeping on the floor after pulling the rug up. It rained wild animals that day and my room flooded to a line a hair's breadth from me. I may not be a crying girl, but when morning came and I saw all that water, all my things taking a swim in it, I broke down and I cried. I wondered why I was suffering in Yola when my parents have houses in Kaduna and Abuja. Only my intense passion for my dreams prevented me from throwing in the towel and moving back home. Then the big no-no happened. I was attacked one dark stormy night by some touts that lived in the neighborhood. I'm sure they planned to rape me, but God saved me yet again. It's still one of the most terrifying moments I've had to endure in my life, you know? Anyway, I had to deal with a house with people who had the "I wouldn't flush the toilet after taking a nasty dump" generator sets that sang horribly and poisoned me daily, a constantly flooded inner and outer room, and loud kids who always stared at me like I fell from the sky in a mushroom space shaped space. I don't even know what I'm saying. Okay. Truth is, I would never have moved to that new neighborhood if I had not been desperate. Desperation never allows for rational thinking and reasoning. I know they say desperate times calls for desperate measures, but desperation will lead to manifold problems. I've had to move houses again, making it the third house I've had to live in the past 10 months. You got it right. The third house. I could go on and on, but I'll leave it there for some time. I hope you learned something from this. You may be in a really terrible situation right now and you feel desperation clutching your heart. It is okay. We all feel the same way at one point or another. But before you make any decision, take a much needed breath. Inhale deeply. Consider all angles. Choose wisely and then hope for the best. It is a mark of wisdom to not make a permanent decision out of a temporary situation, even if that situation feels like you're being bashed by Muhammad Ali in his prime. It is a cliche, but it is true. P.S. I moved to my new house again out of desperation, even after everything I've said. I hope that in a couple of months, I wouldn't have to move again. Ain't nobody got time for that. To end this, I'm going to say, desperate times called and they want their desperate measures back. That's all for this week. Thank you, T.S. Ralph, again for a beautiful day. I'm so grateful. And again, thank you, Diane Debola, for allowing me use your house. The location is awesome. Thank you so much. I'll be back again with a fresh new episode next week. Take care of you. Bye, yeah.
That's all for this week. Subscribe to the channel for more of Shades of Brown. You can also subscribe to my YouTube channel at www.youtube.com/Ochekli Yeramatoada. I'm on Facebook at Ochekli Yeramatoada, on Twitter at Remy Ma, that is at R-E-M-I-M-A-H, and on Instagram at Miss_Remy Ma. You can also follow my blog at www.shadesofbrownnigeria.blogspot.com. For inquiries, mail me at ochekliyeramatoada@gmail.com or ramatoadaochekli@yahoo.com. Talk to you next time. Bye.